Hello everyone, welcome to a new lecture about dynamics. Today we are going to see how to go from quantum dynamics to classical dynamics, or in other words, how to go from the time-dependent Schrödinger equation to the Newton equation of motion. Let's assume we have the following system, the following molecule, which is formed by two nuclei, capital I and capital J, whose coordinates are represented by these capital R letters. And also we have two electrons, small I and small j, whose coordinates are small ri and small rj. If we want to know the time evolution of a non-relativistic quantum mechanical system, we need to solve the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, which is equation number one, where here we have the imaginary number I multiplied by the reduced Planck constant, multiplied by the time evolution of the total wave function. This is equal to the Hamiltonian of the system multiplied by the total wave function. As you can see, the wave function of the system depends on the electron coordinates, the nuclear coordinates, and the time, while the Hamiltonian depends on nuclear and electronic coordinates. The Hamiltonian can be written as the sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy, where the kinetic energy presents two contributions: the nuclear kinetic energy plus the electronic kinetic energy, and then the potential energy presents three terms: the nuclear repulsion, the electronic repulsion, and the electron-nuclei interaction. If we develop each of the terms, we can write the Hamiltonian as equation 3, where we have the first term representing the kinetic energy of nuclei, where we have minus the square of the reduced Planck constant over 2 and the mass of the atom I multiplied by the square of the Laplacian. The Laplacian is just the derivative with respect to the nuclear coordinates, if we are talking about the first term, or with respect to the electron coordinates, if we are talking about the second term, which represents the kinetic energy of electrons. Then, as we said, we have the nuclear repulsion, which is the third term, the electron repulsion, and finally, the interaction between electrons and nuclei. We can just take the last four terms of equation 3, that is, we can take the kinetic energy for electrons and then all the potential energy terms and put it as a general Hamiltonian, which is called electronic Hamiltonian, which we represent as HA. And then we just write the Hamiltonian as the kinetic energy of nuclei plus the electronic Hamiltonian. So if we insert now, if we take the time-dependent Schrödinger equation and here we write kinetic energy of nuclei plus electronic Hamiltonian instead of total Hamiltonian, we get this equation, equation number 5. And now, in order to develop this equation, we will use the Born-Huang formulation to write the total wave function. So the total wave function can be written as a linear combination of electronic wave functions multiplied by some time-dependent coefficients, and these time-dependent coefficients represent the nuclear wave function. And the electronic wave function, phi L in general, are the solution of the time-independent Schrödinger equation, where we use here the electronic Hamiltonian. So the electronic Hamiltonian acting on the electronic wave function is just the electronic energy multiplied by the electronic wave function. So we insert equation number 6 into the time-dependent Schrödinger equation number 5, and we get the following equation. So now we are going to multiply from the left by the electronic wave function of the electronic state k, and then we integrate over the electronic coordinates. So after doing that, equation 8 leads to the following equation. So we have now equation number 9, where we have, in order to be clear, so we are multiplying here on the left by the electronic wave function k, and also here. So we need to look carefully at this equation. So here we have the brackets, okay? Here we have the brackets, and also here. So what we did was multiply by the electronic wave function here on the left. Okay, so now let's analyze the left term, or the left hand term in equation 9, and then we will analyze the right hand term. Okay, so what we can do here is we have here this term, so we have I multiplied by the Planck constant and then the time derivative of the nuclear wave function, because it is the only function which depends on time. So remember, when we do this integral here, when we are applying here these brackets, we said we do the integral we integrate over the electronic coordinates. So everything which doesn't depend on the electronic coordinates can be placed outside of the integral. So this is why we can write here this term outside of the electronic integral here. Okay, now we have here this summation from L equal to 0 to L equal to infinite. So we can develop this summation and we get the following equation. So here we have L equal to 1. So this is why we have here phi 1, here omega 1, L equal to 2. So phi 2, omega 2, and so on. Here in general we write L equal to k, so we have here k and k. Okay, now if we look at each of these terms in the summation, we are multiplying two electronic wave functions, and since the electronic wave functions are orthonormal, this equation will simplify a lot. So for example, here the first integral is equal to 0 because we are multiplying different electronic wave functions. We are multiplying phi k by phi 1, so this is equal to 0. Also the second integral is equal to 0, this one. This one is equal to 1 because we are multiplying the same electronic wave function by itself. So since the wave functions are normalized, this is equal to 1. So equation 11 simplifies to the following equation 12, which is much much shorter. So coming back to the general equation 9, remember equation 9 is a time-dependent Schrödinger equation. The left-hand term is simplified to only this term. So I multiply by h and then the time derivative of the nuclear wave function in the state k. Okay, let's now analyze the right-hand term of equation 9. Okay, the first thing we are going to do is we are going to do this this product here. So we multiply the electronic wave function by this kinetic term, and again by the electronic wave function multiplied by the nuclear wave function. So this is the first term here. And now we do the same with the second term of the parenthesis. So we have electronic wave function multiplied by electronic Hamiltonian and then multiplied by the total wave function. So we have here this second term. Then we can move these summations here outside of the integral. So we are moving the summation to here, and the same with this summation here. So we put it outside of the integral. So this is a, let's say, a legal operation, because that means the integral of a summation is equal to the sum of the integrals. So we can do that. So now if we look here, we look at this term, we have the electronic Hamiltonian multiplied by the electronic wave function. So this is the time independent Schrödinger equation. So it's equal to the electronic energy multiplied by the electronic wave function. So we get equation 15, and now the electronic energy doesn't depend on the electronic coordinates, so we can put this outside of the integral, and we get equation 16. And again, we have here the product of two electronic wave functions. And if we use the orthonormality rule, equation 16 will simplify again. And we get equation 17. where only when L is equal to K, we have here this term. Okay, so now we have here a complicated term. We have the second derivative. We have here the second derivative of the total wave function with respect to the coordinates of the nuclei I. So we need to do this derivative carefully. So instead of writing the square of the Laplacian, we write here first derivative and then again the first derivative. So we need to do the derivative of the total wave function two times. So this is relatively easy, but we need to do it carefully. So let's start by doing the first derivative. So we are going to apply this derivative to the total wave function. So this is a product of two functions, so we need to do the derivative of a product. So it's very easy. This is the derivative of the first function multiplied by the second function as it is, plus the first function multiplied by the derivative of the second function. So very easy. And now we need to do the derivative of all these brackets. Again, this is relatively easy. We need to consider that we have here the derivative of a product first, and then we have the derivative of a second product here. Okay, so this is the result. So this part here is the derivative of the first product, and then this second part is the derivative of this second product here. So this is relatively easy to do. Okay, now if you look here at this pink square, so we have the derivative of the electronic wave function multiplied by the derivative of the nuclear wave function, and then we have again the same. So we can write here a 2 and then this term only one time. Okay, so we can insert now this equation 21 into equation 17, and we get equation 22. Now, what we are going to do is we are going to multiply here the square of the Planck constant over 2 and the mass by each of the terms in the parentheses. So we are going to do this multiplication here, and we get equation 23. And now we introduce the definition of two new properties. So here we define the second order non-adiabatic coupling, capital D, as the everything which is inside this gray square. But the important part is here we have the second derivative of the electronic wave function with respect to the nuclear coordinates. So it is the second derivative. This is why it is called second order non-adiabatic coupling. And now here we have something similar, but now we have the first derivative of the electronic wave function with respect to the nuclear coordinates. So this is called the first order non-adiabatic coupling. So we can rewrite equation 23 as equation 24 using these non-adiabatic couplings. And also when we go from 23 to 24, what we are doing also is we are taking here this constant. So remember, this is a constant. Here we have an electronic integral. So this integral, we are doing the integration over the electronic degrees of freedom. So this constant can go outside of the integral. So we put here the constant. And then what we have here again is the product of two electronic wave functions. So we have here a summation. Remember, only when L is equal to K, this integral will be equal to 1, and otherwise it will be equal to 0. So we can simplify this equation and we get equation 25. Here we have equation 25, where I repeat, only when L is equal to K, so this term is not equal to 0. Okay. So now we have here nuclear wave function, also here nuclear wave function, so we can just write equation 25 as equation 26, where the nuclear wave function multiplied to this parenthesis, where we have the kinetic energy of the nuclei, this is the first term, and then the potential energy of the state K, the electronic state K. So finally, we insert equation 26 into equation 9, and we get, let's say, the final form of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. So here it is. So this is the time-dependent Schrödinger equation that we need to solve in order to know the time evolution of a quantum mechanical system. So here, remember, capital D and small d are the non-adiabatic couplings, which represent how the electronic wave function changes with the nuclear coordinates. Okay. So if we want to investigate the dynamics of a system, we need to solve equation 27, because after solving the equation, we know how the nuclear wave function evolves with time. So we know how the system is moving with time. In order to solve this equation, we need to compute the non-adiabatic couplings, and the non-adiabatic couplings depends on the electronic wave functions. And also, we need to know the electronic energy of the state K in general, so of every state. So we can compute the electronic properties of the system by an ab initio method, solving the time-independent Schrödinger equation, and we can do that on the fly during the dynamics, or we can pre-compute it in advance, and then we just solve equation 27 in this using these pre-computed electronic properties. So when we do that, when we solve equation 27, we said that we are running a quantum dynamics simulation. But as you can imagine, this is very expensive, so it is limited to a few degrees of freedom only, maybe a maximum of 10 degrees of freedom. So we can run quantum dynamics for very small molecules only, maybe molecules with 3 or 4 atoms. But on the other side, this is the exact solution of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. So we take into account quantum effects such as the zero-point energy, tunneling, interference, and all the quantum effects that, that you can imagine. So this is the equation 27 is the exact time-dependent Schrödinger equation. So if we solve it, we take into account the quantum effects. Let's have a look at the non-adiabatic couplings. So we have said that the non-adiabatic couplings represent the variation of the electronic wave function with the nuclear motion. So here we have the second and the first derivative of the electronic wave function with respect to the nuclear coordinates. So we can say that the non-adiabatic coupling describes the interaction between electronic states, between different electronic states, because of the nuclear motion. Or in other words, as we said, we can define the non-adiabatic couplings as the variation of the electronic wave function with the nuclear coordinates. So this is easier to understand if we do a graphical representation. For example, let's assume this blue line is the potential energy surface for the electronic state K. So the wave function of this state is phi K. And now we have a different electronic state L, which cross with the electronic state K. So in this region, in the region where we have a crossing between states, usually the non-adiabatic coupling is very large. So why this is the case? Because, for example, let's say our system is running in the electronic state phi L initially. Okay, so the red state is phi L. So the system is running here, down the gradient, and then in the crossing point it changes to the blue curve, so it changes to the electronic state phi k. So in this region, in this, let's say, a small region where the change in the nuclear coordinates is relatively small, so in this small window of nuclear coordinates, the electronic wave function is changing a lot. So in other words, the variation of the electronic wave function with respect to the nuclear coordinates is relatively large. So these two things, the non-adiabatic couplings, are relatively large in this situation where we have a crossing between different electronic states. However, if we have the situation on the right, the scenario is very different. So for example, now we have the electronic state K well separated from the electronic state L. So this delta E is relatively large. So in this case, if the system is running here, so the system will be in the electronic state K, let's say, for a long time. In other words, the effect of the electronic state L on the dynamics of the electronic state K is not important. So we can assume that the non-adiabatic couplings are equal to zero or very, very small. So in other words, we can use the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, where we assume that the system is running on a single electronic state and there is no interaction with other electronic states. So this is the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation. So coming back to the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, equation 27. So now, if we use the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, we can neglect the non-adiabatic couplings. So all this term is equal to zero, and equation 27 transforms into equation 28. So now we have the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, where we are running the dynamics only on one state, on the state K. So we are running our trajectories on a single electronic state, which in other words, usually we said we are running adiabatic dynamics, because the dynamics is only in one state and there is no interaction with other states. So a possible representation for the nuclear wave function in this equation, in equation 28, is the polar representation, where we are going to represent our system as a wave. So, and the nuclear wave function will be the amplitude of the wave multiplied by the exponential of the phase of the wave. So this is the polar representation of the nuclear wave function. Here, both the amplitude and the phase depends on the nuclear coordinates and also on time. So if we insert equation 29 into equation 28, and remember, equation 28 is the time-dependent Schrödinger equation under the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, so we get the following equation. So we get equation 30. So now we need to analyze this equation in detail. So let's start with the left-hand side of the equation. So here we need to do the derivative, the time derivative of this product. So we have here a product. So as you know, is the derivative of the first function multiplied by the second function as it is, plus the first function multiplied by the derivative of the exponential. And this is the derivative of the exponential of I over h multiplied by the phase s. By the way, here, in order to simplify the equations, so we know that both the amplitude and the phase depends on coordinates and time. So here we will remove this parenthesis, and then we, in order to make the equations a bit shorter. But we know that A and S depends on R and T. Okay, and now we just do this multiplication, IH multiplied by the two terms in the parentheses. Okay. So then this is equation 32. Here, by the way, we are just doing the square of I is equal to minus 1. So we have here a minus, but this is the only change we do. So the left-hand part of the equation is this summation here. Okay, let's analyze now the right part of the equation, which is a bit more involved. Okay, so The first thing we need to do here is this product. So we have this kinetic term multiplied by all this part here, okay, plus the electronic energy multiplied by the wave function, and we get equation 33. Okay, now we have here a first derivative of this, and then we need to do the second derivative. So we need to do this in two steps. So let's do the first derivative. So we have here, so we are going to do this part here, okay? So this is the derivative of a product. So again, it's relatively easy. So this is the derivative of the product. And then we need to do, and this is a bit more complicated, but still is feasible. So we need to do the derivative of all these parentheses. But now we have to do it carefully because, okay, here we have in blue, we need to do the derivative of this product, okay? And the derivative of this product is this term here. This is the easy part. But now we have here this function. And now we will consider that all of this is a second function. But this second function indeed is the product of two functions. So we need to do this in the following way. Okay, so we apply the first derivative to this. So we have the derivative of A multiplied by the second function as it is. And now we have plus the first function, which is A, multiplied by the derivative of the second function. And this second function, as I said, is the product of two functions. So again, we need to do here the derivative of a product. So it is not complicated, but we have to do it carefully. And then the last term here. Okay. So we reorganize a bit equation 35. So what we are doing here is just we do this multiplication I over h multiplied by everything which is inside the parentheses, and also this ak multiplied by everything which is inside this inner parentheses, and we get equation 36. Then, if you look at equation 36, we have in all the terms the exponential, which is the same exponential all the time. So we can put here this exponential multiplying to this parenthesis. Okay. And we get equation 37. Okay, and this is the, let's say, the result of the right hand part of equation 30. So we can then rewrite the equation 30 as equation 38. And in this, in the next step, we multiply this constant by all the terms in the parentheses. And now we are very close to the end. We need to separate the real and the imaginary parts of equation 39. So let's take the real parts of equation 39. We are going to say that the real part on the left hand is equal to the real part on the right hand. So we can write equation 40. And then we are going to take this minus a and put it on the other hand, and we get equation 41. So equation 41 is the first equation of motion, where this equation tells us how the phase of the wave changes with time. So we can do the same, but taking just the imaginary part of equation 39. So we have that the imaginary part on the left is equal to the imaginary part on the right. So we can write equation 42, and we just put this constant on the other side, and we get equation 43, which is the second equation of motion, where this equation tells us how the amplitude of the wave changes with time. Okay, so these two equations, equations 41 and 43, are the exact solutions of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation under the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation. Still, even if we are using the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation, we are solving the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, so the quantum equation of motion, but we are neglecting the non-adiabatic couplings, but still we are quantum. Now, we can take the classical limit, and in the classical limit, we assume that the Planck constant is equal to zero. And for example, if we take equation 41, which is the equation which tells us how the phase of the wave function changes with time, this term will be neglected because h is equal to zero. And then we will get what is called the equation of motion in the Hamilton-Jacobi formulation, which is the classical mechanics formulation, but where a particle is represented as a wave. So this is the equation 44, where we have neglected the quantum mechanical part, which depends on the Planck constant. Then, if we move from the Hamilton-Jacobi formulation to the Lagrangian formulation, now we are talking about individual particles, not about wave. And if we use also the Hamilton-Jacobi definition of linear momentum, which is this one, so the linear momentum is equal to the variation of the phase with respect to the nuclear coordinates of the particle I. So using this equation and changing to the Lagrangian frame, we can write equation 46, which is just the classical Newton equation of motion. So here we are omitting a couple of steps, so we will not see how to change to the Lagrangian frame. We are going to see this change of formulation from Hamilton-Jacobi formulation to Lagrangian formulation in a future lecture. But when we do that, we just get the classical Newton equation of motion. So in summary, we have seen that it is possible to go from the time-dependent Schrödinger equation to the classical Newton equation of motion by first applying the Bohr-Oppenheimer approximation where the non-adiabatic coupling is neglected, and then we need to apply the classical limit where the Planck constant is equal to zero. So under this assumption, and then we change to the Lagrangian formulation, we get the Newton equation of motion, the classical equation of motion from the quantum time-dependent Schrödinger equation. Thank you very much for watching, and see you in the next lecture.